Okay, well, welcome everyone. It's really interesting to hear what's happening in West Oahu, and the connection, I guess, to what I'll be talking about is that we also work with a disadvantaged group of producers that have been marginalized. And there are some big differences. We don't have an academic component, and we work with people that mostly have been farming their whole lives and now find themselves in a really different context and need assistance in order to keep being able to farm. And so I'm going to be talking a little bit about what we do and some of the broader lessons of what we've learned. I hope it will apply beyond the specific context of our demographic. And we are a program based out of a nonprofit called Cultivating. We work with limited resource refugee and immigrant producers. The nonprofit that I work with has several different branches, all related to building and strengthening community food systems. So I'll be talking just about our refugee farmer training program. We also do youth agricultural programs, focused mostly in the summer, but a little bit of year-round curriculum. And we also do a lot of community food access to try to get some of the food that is being grown, sometimes by our program participants, not always, into low-income communities. So before I talk specifically about our program, I just want to put out a couple of statistics about programs that serve immigrant and refugee farmers specifically. This is some research that has been done very recently. And there are, in the survey that this woman did, who actually works with Kim, some of you might have met at this conference, she's one of her students, she surveyed, I think, about 120 different beginning farmer training programs, and 79 had at least some immigrant and refugee farmer participants. There was a pretty big range in what those programs looked like. About a third of them worked just with farmers who independently owned or leased land. About half worked with farmers who had a program-run incubator farm site. And about two-thirds actually worked more on a community garden scale. And there's a pretty big range of services also. About most of the programs provided some kind of farm access support, and most also provided some kind of market access support. And so I think, you know, roughly what's behind these numbers is sometimes extension programs in an area where there's a high number of immigrant farmers, and so they may not provide a training farm site, but they have many refugee and immigrant participants, to programs like ours that are really focused on a specific demographic, and we run and manage an incubator farm site, and we provide that farm access and market access. And also a little bit of background, there is a program called the Refugee Agricultural Partnership Program, which is actually not a USDA program. It's based out of the Office of Refugee Resettlement. But this program really grew out of a recognition that a lot of refugees coming to the U.S. were coming from agricultural backgrounds. And also 100 that I want to make sure I acknowledge is the Beginning Farmer Rancher Development Program out of USDA. And one of the things that they asked for is outcomes-based reporting, which is something that I actually really like, so we kind of use it now to measure our progress. And most people in our program, almost everyone, is still farming after being in the program for a few years. And I think that's really kind of based out of how important it is to them to be doing this kind of work. But we also measure people's change in their on-farm practices and their marketing practices.